She's a lawyer, but she's a good lawyer. We make fun of lawyers, but believe me, if you were going to be going to court, you'd certainly want to have Constance on your side. And basically, I'd never heard of Constance Cumbey. I'd been studying what was going on probably for close to 20 years. And I always knew I was missing something. I knew there was a force out there somewhere that was so vague. There had to be some sort of logic to what was going on in the world, but nothing really made sense. Until I came across a book that was called The Hidden Dangers of the Rainbow, and it was written in the early 1980s, and I read it, and it began to bring me into an understanding of that there really are spiritual forces which are energizing everything that's going on. So without further ado, Constance Cumbey.
Thank you very much. That last talk is a very hard act to follow. And I started sounding alarms on that. The sustainable development component was one of the things I observed back in 1981 when I started my research, and one of the things that alarmed me enough to actually drop 7 years from my law practice and sound alarms on the New Age movement, because I looked at it and I said, my God, this is the stuff of which Nazism was made. They were talking about global population reduction, Lebensraum, living space, breathing room. So I fought two wars over the last 25 years. I've been in two big battles. And I did not initially think they were related, but increasingly I can see the battles are very much related. And the first war was the misfortune to be the first major evangelical critic of the New Age movement. And I stumbled onto it accidentally in 1981. And this is how it happened. My husband lost both legs above the knee in 1979, October 15th, 1979 to be precise. And I was happily practicing law and thinking I was safe for life. And that was a major disruptive factor. I went into literal shock. For the first time in my life, I could solve higher mathematical equations. First and the last time in my life. And I sat there and I was solving logarithms and working advanced mathematical calculations. And you have to understand, I went to law school because it was the only curriculum in the whole university that required no math. And I seriously thought I was going to have to go back to school and retrain to be a doctor. In fact, I bought numerous books on it. Then I went back to normal, 2 + 2 = 3, or is it 5? I'm not sure which. And there was a Methodist bookstore across the street from my downtown Detroit law office, Cokesbury Books. I went in there almost daily just to find things to help me make it from one day to another, because it was a very, very tough period in my life, even after I came back to normal on the mathematics versus the words. And I read things that I thought would get me through a very difficult point of my life. And when I was through with the good books in the store, and they had lots of good books by lots of good authors, I found another line of books. And the books were by Baptists, Catholics, Episcopalians, Presbyterians, Mennonites. And the books were saying things like, we need a new world order. We need to make this paradigm shift. Up until I discovered the New Age movement, I thought paradigm was 20 cents. We need a transformation. We need to see ourselves as part of an interconnected whole. God's ways aren't our ways. Perhaps he intended for us to call him Shiva. And I started thinking I was looking at some very serious religious apostasy combined with some political elements. I worked for the Michigan Legislature, the House of Representatives, before I even became an attorney. And I knew my way around political circles, and I knew political action campaigns when I saw them. And this looked like a combination of religion and politics. So one day I made a little trip over to the Archdiocese of Detroit to see if the same trends were continuing over there. And to my surprise, I saw many of the very same books, same authors, same propaganda line, same cover. Everything was the same, except on the side of the Catholic books was a logo that said Paulist Press. And on the side of the many of the Protestant books that I found with disturbing themes was a logo that said InterVarsity Christian Fellowship. And I thought, isn't this cute? Here all the Protestants are being reached with a call for the New World Order by InterVarsity, and all the Catholics are being reached by Paulist Press. There were other publishers on both sides of the logo. I'm not singling those two out per se. And I thought all it cost them was a little change in logo on the side of the book. And I really didn't put it together. One day I bought five books and took them home and just slashed and underlined, yellow highlighted, and marked the common elements. One of the books was Towards a Human World Order by Gerald and Patricia Meshi, and yes, they were talking about sustainable development. Another book I bought was Rich Christians in an Age of Hunger by Ron Sider. And a book, When Gods Change, Hope for Humanity, by a professor at the Union Graduate School of Theology. I believe his name was John McCoy. Bought a little book on process theology. And the books all sounded far more like each other than they did the respective teachings of their respective denominations. And I wondered, where were they getting this? I thought for the very first time in my life that maybe I should write a book. And I was going to call it, my original thought was, call it Come Out of Her, My People, The Growing Apostasy of American Religious Life. I had no idea I was looking at something far, far bigger. And I had a very prophetic thought that came to me. I never thought of myself as a prophet, but this day I had a thought that was distinctly prophetic. I never thought, would anybody publish your book? Would anybody read your book? The only thought that came to me was, boy, will you ever catch it if you do. Well, I wrote the book. It ended up being called The Hidden Dangers of the Rainbow, and I've been catching it ever since. And what happened to me along the course of that work was very interesting. The opposition came from where I least expected it. The support often came from where I least expected it. When I found these facts that compelled me to write it, I remember I sat there and I thought, political suicide, professional suicide, political suicide, professional suicide. And I finally just started.